We are live on YouTube. Are you ready?
Yes, Dr. Nadi.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. This is Pursue 18B, which is our 196th lecture. And this is Hematology, Malignant Lymphoid and Plasmacytic Diseases. And we are streaming live from RCC Thiruvananthapuram via Kolkata. And we have a very interesting topic today, which is precursor lymphoid neoplasms from A to Z. And to talk on that, we have a very, very well-known person, Dr. Jayasudhai V. She is an MD pathology from GMC Thiruvananthapuram. Presently, she is an associate professor in the Department of Pathology at the famous Regional Cancer Center, Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. Her area of interest is hematopathology, flow cytometry, lymph node pathology, and FISH in lymphoma. She's got multiple national and international publications and peer-reviewed journals. Before I ask Madam to start, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please do not share your screen. Without much delay, let me request ma'am, Dr. Sudha, please start. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Nadi.
Please share your screen and then we'll start.
Yes.
Absolutely fine.
The screen is okay. So, thank you, Dr. Nadi. Good evening, everyone. I will be talking on precursor lymphoid neoplasms or acute lymphoblastic leukemia by lymphoma. So, precursor lymphoid neoplasms are neoplasms composed of blasts of precursor B cell or T cell lineage. Significance of these group of neoplasms are that they are the most common malignancy in children. So acute lymphoblastic leukemia or ALL indicates primary involvement of blood and marrow, whereas lymphoblastic lymphoma primarily involves nodal or extranodal sites and less than 25% blasts in bone marrow. So the annual incidence worldwide is around 1 to 4.75 cases per lakh. Indian incidence varies according to region, and age-adjusted rates of up to 1.4 per million for boys and up to 62.3 per million for girls are reported. And new cases in USA is around 6,000 per year. In our center, around 230 cases, new cases of acute lymphoblastic leukemia are diagnosed per year. Before we go to the topic proper, we will see briefly the B-cell differentiation. So the B cells, they go through various stages of differentiation as they mature from progenitor B cell or the pro B cells to plasma cells. From the pro B cells, they mature to pre B cells with cytoplasmic new heavy chain, which mature to immature B cells with SIGM expression. And the immature B cells further mature to SIGM and SIGD positive naive B cells, and the naive B cells may be seen in all compartments. And the naive B cells on antigen encounter, they mature to germinal center B cells, memory cells and the plasma cells. So you can see that the change in antigen expression as the cell matures to mature plasma cells. So the earliest markers expressed in B cell progenitors are CD34, TDT-79A, CD19 and CD10, and gradually they acquire CD20 on maturation getting a strong positivity of CD20, and then there is a loss of 20 and expression of 38 and CD138 as it matures to plasma cells. So this figure, it's taken from WHO, clearly shows the normal B cell differentiation and its relationship to major B cell neoplasms. So the precursor B cells may undergo apoptosis, or they will mature to naive B cells. They will undergo transformation, proliferation, and ultimately mature to antibody secreting plasma cells or to memory B cells. So these various stages that will be represented in neoplasms. So the precursor B cell neoplasms is derived from the precursor B cells in the bone marrow, composed of progenitor B cells or the pro B cells, then pre B cells and immature B cells. So these various stages that will be represented in B lymphoblastic leukemia or lymphoma. Briefly regarding T cell differentiation, T cells, they arise from early T cell precursors in bone marrow and they express CD34, TDT, the T cell marker CD7, CD5 DIM, and cytoplasmic CD3, not the surface CD3. Surface CD3 will not be expressed in early stage. Why the T cells are called so? Because they mature in thymus. So maturation occurs in thymus, and the cortical thymocytes have got an immature phenotype. These immature T cells, they acquire CD1A with loss of 34 and co-express CD4 and CD8 and increase the surface CD3 expression and TCR expression until they approach the level seen in mature B cells. So cortical thymocytes are typically characterized by CD1A positivity and double positivity for CD4 and CD8. Medullary thymocytes have got a mature T cell phenotype with loss of CD1A and they will express either CD4 or CD8. So cortical thymocytes have got a CD1A positivity with co-expression of 4 and 8, when they mature to medullary thymocytes, they express either 4 and 8. So these various stages will be reflected in TALL bar LBL. So from the early T cell precursor stage, they mature to medullary thymocytes with a clear mature T cell phenotype. Most of the ALL are of B cell lineage, roughly around 80%. So this may possibly due to the difference in the maturation of B cells or T cells, because B cells are bone marrow derived, making their presence as leukemia common, whereas T cells are thymus derived, making their presentation as lymphoma or mediastinal mass common. TALL represents around 15-20% of acute lymphoblastic leukemia. But in India, there is a higher proportion of TALL is reported, around 20-50%. In our center, around 30% of acute lymphoblastic leukemia are of T-cell lineage. As I have already mentioned, most of the lymphoblastic lymphoma is of T-cell lineage. Another important thing regarding acute lymphoblastic leukemia is, unlike AML, there is no agreed upon lower limit for proportion of blasts required to diagnose ALL. In general, the diagnosis is best avoided if blast percentage is less than 20%. This is a revised 4th edition classification of precursor lymphoid neoplasms. They are broadly classified as B lymphoblastic leukemia bar lymphoma NOS, B lymphoblastic leukemia bar lymphoma with recurrent genetic abnormalities, T lymphoblastic leukemia bar lymphoma, and NK lymphoblastic leukemia bar lymphoma. So this is the complete classification, including the 9 subtypes of BALL bar LBL with recurrent genetic abnormalities. So now we will see B lymphoblastic leukemia bar lymphoma NOS. These are neoplasms composed of precursor lymphoid cells of B cell lineage. It's primarily a disease of children. It has got a bimodal age distribution with higher incidence peak in early childhood, with a median age of around 4 years in BALL and around 10 years for TALL. And there is a second lower incidence peak in the older adults in their 50s. Regarding the etiology of acute lymphoblastic leukemia, etiology is unknown. Although there is an increased risk of BALL bar LBL associated with certain genetic and environmental factors. Although these are not well defined, Certain factors like ionizing radiation, Down syndrome and other constitutional genetic disorders, then single nucleotide polymorphisms of several genes, including GATA3, are associated with increased susceptibility of B lymphoblastic leukemia. Single nucleotide polymorphism means they are germline substitution of a single nucleotide at a specific portion in genome. Coming to clinical features, they can present with weakness or pallor due to anemia, fatigue and bruising due to thrombocytopenia, and fever due to granulocytopenia. They can present with low, normal, or elevated WBC count. Unexplained pancytopenia may warrant a bone marrow diagnosis to exclude leukemia. They can have hepatosplenomegaly and lymphadenopathy may be present at diagnosis, and there may be organ dysfunction also due to leukemic infiltrates. They can present with bone or joint pain due to intramedullary growth of tumor cells. And B lymphoblastic lymphoma, the most common site of involvement are skin, soft tissue, lymph nodes and bone. Coming to morphology. Morphology can vary from small blasts with scanty cytoplasm, contains chromatin and indistinct nucleoli, to larger cells with moderate amount of basophilic cytoplasm, occasionally vacuolated, dispersed chromatin and multiple variably prominent nucleoli. The cytoplasmic vacuoles may be present and this finding do not automatically indicate both leukemia but lymphoma. So what is the importance of understanding this morphology? Importance of morphology is that recognition of lymphoblast is important to initiate the appropriate diagnostic evaluation. So previous classification schemes attempted to subdivide ALL on the basis of morphology, but apart from distinguishing Burkitt leukemia bar lymphoma from ALL, subdividing ALL on the basis of morphology alone has little prognostic value and has been replaced by the immunophenotype, cytogenetic and molecular classification. Coming to the morphological variation, they can have coarse acerophilic granules. They are present in some lymphoblasts in 10% cases. And they can have hand mirror cells due to cytoplasmic pseudopods. But these hand mirror cells are not specific for ALL. They can be present in AML, ALL, myeloma, etc. So it is not a very specific finding. Cytochemistry in lymphoblastic leukemia. Cytochemistry seldom contributes to the definitive diagnosis of ALL. Lymphoblasts are myeloperoxidase negative and PAS will show coarse granular positivity, referred to as block positivity. In our center, for all cases of acute leukemia, we do MPO stain. Or MPO is the only cytochemical marker we routinely do. If MPO is negative, immunophenotyping is absolutely indicated to assign the lineage. PAS also sometimes we do to differentiate B-blastic and Burkitt lymphoma, because some cases of B-blastic is PAS positive, whereas Burkitt lymphoma will be PAS negative. Again, the B blast can be PAS negative. In that case, it won't help. So if it is PAS positive, then the diagnosis becomes B lymphoblastic leukemia. Coming to immunophenotyping, lymphoblast in BALL and LBL is almost always positive for B cell markers, CD19, cytoplasmic 79A, cytoplasmic CD22. Although none of these markers by itself is specific for the B cell lineage. Other markers are CD10, PAX5, TDT, surface CD2, surface CD22. Importance of PAX5 is that PAX5 is the most sensitive and specific B cell marker in tissue sections. So the most important thing is none of these B cell markers by itself are specific, and positivity in combination or high intensity support the diagnosis. For example, CD19 can be positive in AML T821. Cytoplasmic 79A is suggested as both a sensitive and specific marker of BALL, but it may also be expressed in AML and also a significant fraction of TALL. Cytoplasmic CD22 is also a very sensitive marker of BALL, but may also be expressed in AML or the acute myeloid leukemia. Studies have found that CD22 positivity in AML is actually due to a cross-reactive protein found in AML. So positivity both cytoplasmic and surface CD22 that appear to be restricted to B cells. CD20, CD34, CD45 are variable. CD45 is not expressed in 10-20% of cases and they show considerable variability of expression in remaining cases. So we should be aware that LCA can be negative in ALL, and so LCA negativity do not exclude a hematological malignancy. Myeloid associated antigens including CD13, CD33, CD15, they are seen in around 10 to 15% of childhood ALL and around 25% of adult ALL. CKD or the CD117 is only very rarely present, less than 1% cases overall. Another important finding is MPO or the myeloperoxidase can sometimes be detected by immunohistochemistry or flow cytometry and should not automatically exclude a diagnosis of BALL or LBL. Several anti-MPO antibodies have been shown to react with B lymphoblasts in IHC and flow cytometry, but it actually constitutes a non-specific staining. These should not be considered MPAL or the mixed phenotype acute leukemia if weak MPO expression is the only evidence of myeloid differentiation. So the additional criteria that can be helpful for diagnosis include expression of the myeloid antigens like CD117 and very bright CD13 and CD33. So assigning B-cell lineage in mixed phenotype acute leukemia B-bar myeloid or any mixed phenotype with a B-cell component, there are definite strong criteria are there. So strong CD19 with one or more of the markers strongly expressed. It can be CD79A, cytoplasmic CD22 or CD10 or weak 19 with two or more markers strongly expressed. BALL can be classified according to the degree of differentiation into early precursor BALL or the pro-BALL which express 19, 79A, cytoplasmic CD22 and TDT. So the early markers will be expressed. Then there is a common BALL, which will be CD10 positive. Then the most mature stages include the pre-BALL expressing cytoplasmic mu chain and the transitional BALL, which express surface heavy chain without light chain. Clonal surface immunoglobulin light chain is characteristically absent, although it does not completely exclude the possibility of BALL bar LBL. And this classification has got clinical and genetic correlates. Early pre-BALL or the pro-BALL has got a favorable prognosis, and the outcome of pre-BALL and common ALL is similar. One study has shown that adults with this pro-BALL had T411 in around 30% of cases and pH positive in around 9% cases. So presence of these translocations, they confer a bad prognosis. And also the most mature stages, they occur in older children with morphology resembling Burkitt and higher incidence of CNS involvement. So this is one of our case, 1-year-old girl presented with anemia, thrombocytopenia and raised WBC count. Peripheral smear showed 60% blast, so diagnostic of acute leukemia, and flow cytometry was done in peripheral blood. So the flow cytometry was done in LCA gating. The blasts are positive for CD10, CD20, CD19, and CD34. So this phenotype is diagnostic of a B lymphoblastic lineage. 10, 20, CD19 and CD34 showing a variable positivity. You can also note that that green population that represents the mature lymphocyte which serves as internal control in this case. So based on internal control, we can check the intensity and use as a reference to call it as positive. The blasts are CD5 negative, 8 negative, all the T-cell markers are negative, 4, 3 and 7 negative. Myeloid markers are also negative, CD33 negative, CD64 negative, 13 negative, 117 negative, HLA-DR positive. Coming to cytoplasmic markers, the blasts are positive for CD79A and negative for MPO and cytoplasmic CD3. So the flow cytometry shows a dominant population of blast with dim CD45 and positive for CD19, CD10, CD34 and CD79A. So these findings are diagnostic of B lymphoblastic leukemia. This is a straightforward case of B lymphoblastic leukemia. Sometimes you have to do immunohistochemistry in bone marrow biopsy also. So as I have already told, PAXPA is the most sensitive and specific marker of B cell lineage. So this is a case of ALL. The blasts are positive for PAX5, GDT and CD10 and focal positive for CD20. So this is a case of B lymphoblastic leukemia diagnosed in a bone marrow biopsy. While we are discussing about acute lymphoblastic leukemia, we should be aware of hematogones also. So what are hematogones? They are normal B cell precursors which can mimic lymphoblasts. That is their importance. They can mimic lymphoblasts and typically have even higher NC ratio, more homogeneous chromatin and no discernible nucleoli. The highest percentage of hematogones are seen in infant marrows. And they are also increased in a variety of conditions like regenerative marrow, immune-mediated cytopenias and acquired immunodeficiency. Hematogones are classified into three stages. So the stage 1 are the early hematogones, stage 2 are the intermediate hematogones, and the stage 3 are the late hematogones. So stage 1 hematogones, they express CD19 and also the immature markers TDT and 34 and CD10 bright. Decrease in the CD10 expression and loss of TDT and 34 marks the transition to stage 2 hematogones, which are the most abundant hematogone population in most marrow specimens. CD20 is acquired with increasing intensity, as is the surface light chains. Expression of CD20 at the level of B cells signify the stage 3 hematogones, which will still be CD10 positive, although it will be diminished. Intensity will be diminished. So these are the three stages of hematogones. Hematogones show a continuum of expression of markers of B cell maturation, including surface immunoglobulin light chain and a reproducible pattern of acquisition and loss of normal antigen. BALL show a pattern that differs from normal, with either overexpression or underexpression of many markers. So these differences are important in assessment of MRD or the measurable residual disease. This is the flow cytometry done in case of hematogones, showing the stage 1, stage 2 and the stage 3 hematogones done in LCA gating. Stage 1 is demonstrated by HG1, stage 2 is designated as HG2 and stage 3 is represented as HG3, and that is admixed with the mature lymphocytes. So LCA is dim in stage 1, moderate in stage 2, whereas it is bright in stage 3. And also seen in the right is the 10-20 plot, which is very useful because stage 1 hematogones will show bright 10 positive and negative for 20, whereas stage 2 will show CD10 positive but it will be dimmer than stage 1. And most important thing is it acquires CD20 expression, and the stage 3 is characterized by 10 positive, again gradually decreasing in density, but it will still be positive along with bright 20. Finally, there's the mature lymphocytes, which are bright CD20 positive and CD10 negative. And mature lymphocytes are not taken in the hematogone calculation. This is a summary of immunophenotype of hematogones, as we have already discussed. An ideal flow cytometry panel to differentiate blasts and hematogones should include the markers expressed in varying intensity with B cell maturation, that is CD10, 19, 20, 34, 38 and 45. So other helpful markers which help to differentiate hematogones and the abnormal blasts, they are CD9, which shows abnormal uniform expression in blasts, CD81, which show an aberrant underexpression in B lymphoblastic leukemia, CD49F, which show an overexpression in B lymphoblastic leukemia, and CD123 concordance with CD34. So that will be seen in 90% of BALL, whereas it will be discordant expression in hematogones. Differentiating hematogones and blasts in bone marrow biopsy. Sometimes in bone marrow biopsies, in some cases, example as in staging marrows in children, there will be increase in hematogones and this may be mistaken for blasts. So we can have some idea of whether they are blasts or hematogones in bone marrow biopsy also. So in hematogones, PAX5 positive cells will be more than 20 positive cells, which will be more than TDT and 34 positive cells. So a practical way to differentiate is that the 20 positive cells will be more than TDT positive cells. And another point of difference is only small clusters of TDT positive cells will be seen in hematogones. Hematocytes will mainly be seen singly, and even if they cluster, it will be less than or equal to 5-cell cluster. Now we'll go to BALL with recurrent genetic abnormalities. Recurrent genetic abnormalities means specific chromosomal changes. So these categories, they have been chosen. There are 9 categories, and these categories have been chosen because they have distinct clinical, phenotypic and prognostic implications. Coming to BALL bar LBL with T922, it has got the worst prognosis of all the major cytogenetic subtypes of ALL. It shows frequent expression of myeloid antigen, and CD25 is highly associated with Ph positive ALL, at least in adult patients. BALL bar LBL MLL rearranged, it's the most common leukemia in infants, constituting around 60-70% of infant leukemias, around 8% of pediatric ALL, and around 10% of adult ALL. MLL stands for mixed lineage leukemia. The term MLL stands for mixed lineage leukemia because this rearrangement is seen in both AML and ALL. So this is in contrast to most other abnormalities which are lineage specific. It has got a poor prognosis, and the typical immunophenotype is 19 positive, 10 negative, CD15 positive and NG2 positive. So these leukemias will be 10 negative and 15 positive, and another specific marker is NG2 positive. So what is NG2? NG2 stands for neuron glial antigen 2. MLL rearranged leukemias are characterized by specific expression of this NG2. NG2 is involved in leukemia invasiveness and CNS infiltration in MLL rearranged BALL. NG2 is also a therapeutic target for MLL rearranged ALL. And MLL rearranged leukemias, they can be detected by conventional karyotyping, FISH or RT-PCR. Next is BALL bar LBL with T1221 or the TEL-AML1. It occurs in approximately 25% of childhood ALL, making it the most prevalent chromosomal abnormality. It is almost non-existent in adult ALL. Immunophenotypically characterized by frequent myeloid antigen expression and is detected by FISH or RT-PCR. It's very difficult to detect by conventional morphologic methods. So we have to use FISH or RT-PCR, and has got an excellent prognosis. Next is BALL bar LBL with hyperdiploidy, has got a favorable prognosis. Hyperdiploidy refers to more than 50 chromosomes. BALL bar LBL with hypodiploidy has got a poor prognosis even if they do not have measurable residual disease following treatment. So the MRD we will discuss later. So this hypodiploidy, it refers to fewer than 44 chromosomes. Hypodiploidy is actually further subdivided into near haploid, low hypodiploid, high hypodiploid and near diploid. Near haploid will have 23 to 29 chromosomes. Low hypodiploid will have 33 to 39 chromosomes. High hypodiploid will have 40 to 43 chromosomes. And near diploid will be having 44 to 45 chromosomes. And near diploid is not included as a hypodiploid ALL, at least for treatment purposes. BALL bar LBL with G514. Is characterized by variable eosinophilia, and diagnosis can be made with typical immunophenotype and genetic findings even if blast count is low. As in AML with T821-1517, even if the blast count is low, if we can demonstrate this abnormality, then we can give it as BALL bar LBL with T514. And the typical immunophenotype is blasts have 19 positive, 10 positive phenotype. So presence of even small number of blasts with this phenotype in a patient with eosinophilia strongly suggests the diagnosis. BALL bar LBL T119 has got a poor prognosis. It has got unique immunophenotype and genetic features. It is characterized by immunophenotype 19 positive, 10 positive, 9 positive, cytoplasmic mu heavy chain positive, and it's 34 negative. So in this case, blasts harbor translocation between TCF3 on chromosome 19 and PBX1 on chromosome 1. So many treatment protocols no longer require the identification of this entity. Also, finding of the unique immunophenotype and genetic features, they support the inclusion as a cell-specific entity. BALL with intrachromosomal amplification of chromosome 21 is typically diagnosed by fish with a PROC4 Annex 1 gene that reveals 5 or more copies of gene or 3 or more extra copies in a single abnormal chromosome 21. It occurs in older children with low WBC count associated with adverse prognosis. This can be overcome with more aggressive therapy. BCR-ABL1, like BALL, it has got an adverse prognosis. Response of some cases to tyrosine kinase inhibitor therapies. Why it is called BCR-ABL1 like is because they exhibits gene expression profile similar to BCR-ABL1 positive ALL. It's more likely in males, Down syndrome, and characterized by higher MRD levels post-induction. Next, we will see one interesting case. Case 1, 23-year-old male who presented with thigh swelling and intra-abdominal lymphadenopathy. His blood counts, peripheral smear, and bone marrow revealed a normal study. Biopsy was done from the thigh swelling in an outside hospital and was diagnosed as soft tissue sarcoma and thus referred to our center. Trochoid biopsy was done from the lymph node in our center, and this is a scanner view and a hyperview. Section showed atypical cells arranged diffusely. They were medium size with scanty cytoplasm, regular nuclear membrane, and fine chromatin. Extensive crush artifact was seen. So it was a poorly differentiated malignant neoplasm. Morphologically, initial differentials were rhabdomyosarcoma, synovial sarcoma, or a hematologic malignancy. So the initial IHC panel in such a case will be cytokeratin, LCA, desmin myogenin for rhabdomyosarcoma, and TLE1 for synovial sarcoma. But these initial markers, they were all negative. Cytokeratin, LCA, desmin myogenin, and TLE1 was negative. So further IHC was done to exclude lymphoblastic lymphoma, because if this is a hematological malignancy with LCA negativity, that is CD45 negative, then it's more likely to be lymphoblastic lymphoma. So a panel to exclude lymphoblastic lymphoma was done, which include TDT 34 and 10, CD20 and PAX5 for the B cell lineage. Typically B blastic will be PAX5 positive and 20 dim or negative. CD3 epsilon as a T cell marker, and myeloperoxidase for myeloid lineage. So the tumor cells showed strong positivity for PAX5, strong nuclear positivity for PAX5 and CD10, and 20 was focally positive. So this is the case of B lymphoblastic lymphoma, as the bone marrow was normal. But additionally, in this case, myeloperoxidase was also positive. So because myeloperoxidase turned positive, other myeloid lineage markers were kept, and CD33 and c-kit was also done. Both were negative. So as we have already discussed, isolated MPO expression by IHC or flow cytometry can be seen in BALL bar LBL and do not always indicate a mixed phenotype lineage. So the final diagnosis in this case was B lymphoblastic lymphoma. So how to explain the MPO positivity in lymphoblast in immunohistochemistry? Commonly available monoclonal MPO antibodies, they do not react in paraffin-embedded fixed tissue. So more commonly, polyclonal MPO antibodies are used, and this polyclonal MPO detects an antigen other than MPO protein or a variant of MPO protein in B lymphoblast. So that's why we sometimes get a positive MPO in BALL. So MPO positivity, polyclonal MPO positivity without other lymphoid antigen, that will remain a reliable means of diagnosing AML in tissue sections. So always a panel of antibodies are needed in such cases. Second interesting case, case number 2. 14-year-old female presented with anemia and a leukoerythroblastic blood picture. Bone marrow findings were suggestive of acute leukemia, and flow cytometry was done in bone marrow aspirate under LCA gating, and the blasts were positive for CD10, negative for 20. CD19 was negative to dim expression, CD34 negative. All the T cell markers were negative and all the myeloid markers were negative. Among cytoplasmic markers, only 79A was positive, MPO negative, and cytoplasmic CD3 was also negative. So basically, the blasts were positive for CD10 and CD79A and other lineage markers, and was negative for other myeloid and lymphoid markers. So we could not convincingly assign lineage with this flow cytometry data. But because of CD10 positivity, we were in favor of acute lymphoblastic leukemia. CD79A was also positive, so suspicious of B lymphoblastic leukemia. But CD19 was negative to DIM. So this much DIM positivity we have not seen yet. So we did immunohistochemistry in bone marrow biopsy also. So the blasts were positive for PAX5, strong nuclear positivity for PAX5. So the diagnosis is B lymphoblastic leukemia, CD19 DIM to negative, which is very rare. There are case reports and case series of 90 negative BALL. Those 90 negative BALL is rare. In this current era of 19 targeted immunotherapy, 90 negative BALL relapses are getting more frequent. Coming to WHO updates, two provisional entities were added in the revised fourth edition classification, that is BALL with intrachromosomal amplification of chromosome 21 and BCR-ABL1 like BALL, both of which we have already discussed. So now coming to TALL bar LBL, they are neoplasms composed of lymphoblasts of precursor T-cell lineage. Majority of the T-lymphoblastic lymphoma involve the mediastinum, related to the maturation of T-cells in thymus. TALL constitute around 15% of childhood ALL. T-lymphoblastic lymphoma constitute around 90% of lymphoblastic lymphoma. Lymphoblastic lymphomas are more common in late childhood and characterized by male predominance. Clinical features are typically present with high tumor burden, including high peripheral WBC count, organomegaly, peripheral lymphadenopathy, and children are typically older than for BALL, and mediastinal mass that is typically associated with a T-cell phenotype. And like BALL, they can also present with anemia, thrombocytopenia, organomegaly and bone lesion, but they are less frequently leukopenic when compared to BALL. Distinguishing TALL from BALL by morphology alone is impossible. Immunophenotyping of TALL bar LBL. Lymphoblasts in TALL bar LBL are usually TDT positive. TDT will be expressed in around 90% cases overall, and they variably express CD1A, CD2, CD3, 4, 5, 7, and 8. So variably express the other T-cell markers. CD7 and cytoplasmic CD3 are most often positive. They are the most frequently expressed markers. We have not seen a case of TALL which is negative for 7 and cytoplasmic CD3. So 7 and cytoplasmic CD3 are most often positive. Of this, only CD3 is considered lineage specific. Surface CD3 is often absent in T lymphoblastic leukemia. CD4 and CD8 are frequently co-expressed on blast and 10 may be positive. CD4, CD8 is variable with double positive, double negative and single positive cases described. CD1A also help to indicate the precursor nature of lymphoblasts, and that will be expressed in around 40% of cases. And TALL bar LBL can also be classified according to differentiation as pro-T, pre-T, cortical T and medullary T. And this pro-T and pre-T, many cases are now definitely will meet the criteria of ETP-ALL, which we will discuss later. And the cortical T is characterized by double positive phenotype and CD1A positivity, whereas medullary T cells express either CD4 or CD8. They have got a mature T cell phenotype. And some studies have shown that correlation between T cell differentiation and survival. And TALL tend to have a more immature phenotype than T lymphoblastic lymphoma. This is one of our case. A 17-year-old male patient presenting with high WBC count. Pertuzumab was diagnostic of acute leukemia. The flow cytometry was done in LCA gating and the blasts were positive for CD10, negative for 20 and 19. So clearly positive for the T-cell markers, CD5, CD8, CD7, CD4 and CD3. CD3 is positive, but as you can see, it shows a DIM expression as compared to CD7 and CD5, suggesting of T lymphoblastic lineage. If it is a mature T-cell lymphoma, CD3 will be bright positive with frequent loss of 7. So that is one difference between T lymphoblastic and mature T-cell neoplasms. Mature T will be showing bright CD3 positive with frequent loss of 7 or 5. And all the myeloid markers are negative, as you can see, CD33, CD64, CD117, negative. T-cell alpha beta is positive, CD1A negative, and positive for cytoplasmic CD3. MPO and cytoplasmic CD79A is negative. So the flow cytometry data revealed a predominant population of blasts, which are CD5 positive, 7 positive, surface CD3 positive, CD4 positive, 8 positive, and cytoplasmic CD3 positive. So this data is diagnostic of T lymphoblastic leukemia. So this is a clear-cut case of T lymphoblastic leukemia. Coming to WHO updates, one subset with unique biology is now recognized as a provisional entity in the revised 4th edition classification, that is the early T precursor ALL or the ETP ALL. So by definition, blasts in ETP ALL, they express CD7 but lack CD1A and 8 and positive for one or more of the myeloid or stem cell markers, CD34, CD117, HLA-DR, 13, 33, 11B or 65. So they will be negative for 1A and CD8 and positive for one or more of myeloid or stem cell markers. 5 is often negative, and when present, it is present in less than 75% of blast population. So actually, the initial description of this entity suggested that the outcome was poor compared to other patients of T-ALL, but largest studies to date with more effective therapy have shown no prognosis significance, despite the fact that MRD after induction therapy is generally higher in ETP-ALL. So the measurable residual disease after induction therapy may be higher in ETP-ALL. Despite that, ultimate outcome with appropriate therapy remains same. Another entity is the indolent T lymphoblastic proliferation, which was briefly mentioned in the 4th edition classification, is now a more readily recognized non-neoplastic entity, and the importance is that can mimic T lymphoblastic lymphoma. So we should be aware of this. So it involves the lymphoid tissue of the upper aerodigestive tract, and the phenotype reflects a developmentally normal, non-aberrant phenotype, and the proliferations are not clonal, and they are associated with Castleman disease, follicular dendritic cell sarcoma, and angioimmunoblastic T-cell lymphoma. There are specific criteria to diagnose indolent T lymphoblastic proliferation. There will be confluent groups of TDT-positive T lymphoblasts, relative preservation of normal architecture, absence of morphological ATP and thymic epithelium, non-clonal population, developmentally normal thymic T-cells, and has got an indolent clinical course. We'll go to the next interesting case. 8-year-old male diagnosed with T lymphoblastic leukemia in 2017, and this is the morphology of the blast in bone marrow aspirate at the time of diagnosis. During maintenance therapy, chin swelling measuring 4 into 3.5 cm occurred, and peripheral smear and bone marrow studies were normal at that time. This is the swelling with reddish discoloration of skin, and there was associated fever also for this boy. Imaging studies showed lytic lesion with sclerotic margin involving the mandible and a single lytic lesion in the right distal radius and the right distal femur. FNAC was done from the chin swelling. It showed cellular smears composed of atypical cells, large cells resembling histiocytes with pale vacuolated cytoplasm and enlarged pleomorphic nuclei with nucleoli on some cells, and few binucleate and few cells showing phagocytosis were also seen. This is the histological section from the mandibular mass. HNE section showed sheets of cells with amphiphilic granular cytoplasm, enlarged pleomorphic nuclei and variable nucleoli. And the nuclei had frequent grooves, indentations, and occasional atypical mitotic figures were also seen. And we did immunohistochemistry for KP1 and PGM1, CD68, and was positive. So these cells were KP1 positive. So our impression was histiocytic lesion bar neoplasm. Because of the unusual presentation, we sent it for expert opinion to Dr. Elaine Jaffe in National Cancer Institute, USA. And their diagnosis was atypical histiocytic infiltrate consistent with histiocytic sarcoma. They also did a T-cell receptor gene rearrangement in this biopsy and also found out a clonal rearrangement pattern. So this was a case of histiocytic sarcoma transdifferentiated from T lymphoblastic leukemia. Although we have read of such a possibility in textbooks, this was our first encounter with such a case. Next interesting case is case number 4, a 68-year-old female who presented with mesenteric mass. We can well appreciate the hyaline vascular lesion. So this is a case of Castleman disease hyaline vascular type. This case actually didn't require immunohistochemistry, but we just did a basic panel of CD3, CD20 and MIB1. So we found that the cells in focal area showed high MIB1 in a nodular pattern, and these cells were also CD3 positive and 20 negative. So they were not the follicle cells, they were 3 positive. So figure A showing the high MIB1 in nodular pattern as compared to the other figure where it's showing the low MIB. Additionally, T cells in the nodular area was also TDT positive. So this was a case of indolent T lymphoblastic proliferation in a Castleman disease. Although in this case we could identify it as indolent, problem may arise if we get a true cut biopsy from such an area. So we can easily misdiagnose them as a T lymphoblastic lymphoma. Coming to NK cell lymphoblastic leukemia or lymphoma, it's a provisional entity. Diagnosis is considered in cases that express CD56, immature T cell markers CD7, CD2 and even cytoplasmic CD3. They lack myeloid and B cell markers. T cell receptor and immunoglobulin genes are in germline configuration, that is they will be unmutated, and blastoplasmacytodendritic cell neoplasms are excluded. Coming to prognosis in acute lymphoblastic leukemia or lymphoma, first is the lineage of leukemia. So T-ALL is generally considered a high-risk disease than B-ALL. So this may be due to the presence of high-risk clinical features in T-ALL like older age, higher WBC count. However, T-ALL patients lacking these high-risk features, they do not fare as good as B-ALL unless intensive treatment is given. However, the prognosis of T-ALL may be better than B-ALL in adult patients, possibly due to lower incidence of adverse cytogenetic abnormalities. So T-ALL is generally considered higher risk than B-ALL. Then infancy, older age, higher WBC count and slow response to initial treatment, they are all adverse prognostic factors. Coming to older age, so patients over the age of 60 years have a particularly poor prognosis, and this may be partly because elderly tend to have disease with unfavorable biology, for example pH positive or hypodiploidy and complex karyotype. They'll be having more medical comorbidities or inability to tolerate the standard chemotherapy regimen. So older age cutoff is 60 years, it's got a poor prognosis. And higher WBC count, the B-ALL with counts more than 30,000 as an adverse prognostic factor. Similarly, T-ALL with counts more than 1 lakh is an adverse prognostic factor. Then coming to cytogenetic and molecular abnormalities, we have already discussed the abnormalities with good and bad prognostic outcome. Although recurrent genetic abnormalities are also reported in T-ALL, it's already discussed in the B-ALL. But it's also described in T-ALL. At present, they are not used to delineate specific categories in T-ALL in WHO classification. Then percentage of bone marrow involvement by blast and presence of blast in CSF. These two factors may help in further tailoring of therapy in various treatment protocols. Last and most important is the MRD detection by molecular or flow cytometry. The detection of MRD or the measurable residual disease by flow cytometry or molecular studies has emerged as a strong prognostic factor. So what is this minimal residual disease, or now it is known as measurable residual disease? It is a disease which is undetectable by conventional morphologic methods. By morphology as examination of bone marrow aspirates, it will be completely normal. So MRD is a disease which is undetectable by the conventional morphologic methods, or it is the lowest level of disease detectable in patient in complete clinical remission by the most sensitive technique available. So the techniques for detection of MRD are molecular, that is PCR, next generation sequencing and flow cytometry. In general, the molecular methods are more sensitive than flow cytometry. Flow cytometry, the sensitivity is around 10 raised to minus 4 to 10 raised to minus 5, whereas PCR it is 10 raised to minus 4 to 10 raised to minus 6. And levels of more than 0.01% abnormal blasts have been established to have a clinical significance with higher levels indicating poor prognosis. So more than 0.01% blast has got clinical significance. It has got adverse prognosis. And the importance of MRD in TALL is, in TALL, none of the markers except MRD was found to be a predictor of outcome. So it's very important in TALL also. Lastly, coming to the differential diagnosis. So BALL always has to be differentiated from hematogonads that we have already discussed. Hematogonads, morphologically, it will show indistinct or absence of nucleolin. And most important distinction is they show a continuum of B-cell antigen acquisition with stage 1, stage 2 and stage 3 hematogonads. And the differential is small round cell neoplasm. They have to be differentiated by morphology, then absence of lymphoid marker expression. You should also note that ALL or LBL share the morphology and the CD99 positivity of Ewing sarcoma. So sometimes it is very difficult and you have to use a panel of ISC markers. Next differential is Burkitt lymphoma. So Burkitt bar plastic. So for that distinction, we need flow cytometry, immunohistochemistry and FISH. By flow cytometry, we can demonstrate the light chain restriction that will be favoring Burkitt lymphoma. An immunohistochemistry panel for a blastic bar Burkitt case that includes CD20, CD5, BCL2, BCL6, MIP, CD10, TDT34 and CNIC. So this is the panel we require for differentiating a blastic and Burkitt. And Burkitt lymphoma is characteristically BCL2 negative, BCL6 positive and CNIC strongly positive. And we can also depend on FISH for CNIC gene rearrangements. Next differential is acute leukemia of ambiguous lineage. So strict criteria have to be followed as mentioned in the revised WHO classification for assigning lineage. Another differential is blast crisis of CML. So blast crisis of CML versus pH positive ALL. So diagnosis is easy if there is a history of CML. But if the patient initially presents in the blast phase of CML, then it is difficult. Then presence of certain factors like presence of basophilia, eosinophilia, myeloid hyperplasia with increase in immature cells, presence of micromegakaryocytes in marrow, they all help to differentiate CML. So all these features will be favoring CML. And it can also be differentiated by RT-PCR and FISH because the fusion protein in pediatric ALL is usually P190. Whereas in CML, it's usually P210. So this difference can be made use to differentiate. And another way we can differentiate blast crisis of CML versus PH-positive ALL is by FISH. So in FISH, 100% of cells will be pH positive in CML or percentage of the pH positive cell exceed the blast population in CML because the background cells also will be carrying the translocation. Other differential is the blastoid variant of mantle cell lymphoma will be showing a mature T cell phenotype with CD20 and CD5 co-expression and cyclin D1 expression. And another differential is a large B cell lymphoma which will be expressing a mature B cell phenotype. So in difficult cases, large B-cell lymphomas, you may also ask for the excision biopsy of lymph node. So these are, in general, the differential diagnosis. So these are some of my references. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah, Dr. Nadir. Yeah, I'm audible.
Yeah. Can you just stop sharing, please?
Yeah.
Right. Thank you so much. Just can you just hold on? We will just see if there are any questions on the YouTube.
Yeah, definitely.
Anybody in the Google Meet, if you want to ask any question to Dr. Jayasudha, can ask directly. You can unmute and ask straight away.
Ma'am, can I ask a doubt?
Yes, ma'am.
You told about the indolent T-cell proliferation that can be mistaken in a two-cut biopsy for a lymphoblastic lymphoma.
So yes.
Such a case if you receive a two-cut biopsy and you get TDT-positive cells.
It's a very difficult scenario. Once we got such a case, pediatric case with abdominal mass, not the case which I have discussed, a pediatric case with an abdominal mass. There were few TDT-positive cells, but we could not convincingly say that some difficulty because T lymphoblastic lymphoma presenting as abdominal mass itself is very rare. So we didn't give a diagnosis, and later they followed up that patient and found that they have got an autoimmune disorders. So they finally got treated for that, and so actually it must have been, because if it's a leukemia, then it will eventually evolve, right? So we have to correlate it with clinical and all the other findings.
Thank you.
That is Dr. Lakshmi Umashankar. Is it okay? You want to ask any further question, Dr. Lakshmi?
No. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
It's difficult only, but we should be aware of that. Then we can at least avoid that. If there is any difficulty, we can ask for an excision biopsy of node. Because indolent T lymphoblastic proliferation won't present like a T lymphoblastic lymphoma. Clinically, they will have an idea, definitely.
Right. Anybody else would like to ask any question? We are waiting for the YouTube people to ask anything. I'm just checking up with them. There's a slightly delay in the transmission between Google Meet and YouTube, so we just have to wait a bit. Here on the Google Meet, if anybody would like to ask any question. Furthermore, let me clarify that in case there are any questions, you can also put up in the Telegram group of ours. We can put it up to the speaker, and then you can, whatever the answer be, we can relate that to the person who has the query. And Dr. Jayashuda, there are no questions on the YouTube as of now. Thank you so much for this wonderful presentation. It was very extensive.
Thank you, Dr. Nathan.
The very content tells us that how much effort you have taken in putting this whole thing up. Thank you so much. And definitely it will be of much, very much use for the students as well as for the consultants. And we have the concept of having the entire thing recorded in the YouTube. So we'll be sharing with you the YouTube recording link. And anybody, whoever wants to go back and view this, can view it on the YouTube. Thank you, ma'am. And we will definitely like you to come back on this platform with something much more. We'll definitely get
back
to you.
Thank you, Dr. Nadim. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. God bless you. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.